What do you think of when you hear the word science? Maybe you think of biology, chemistry, lab coats, or even the funny face of Einstein. But I bet you the last thing you would ever consider is religion. We treat religion and science a lot like baking soda and vinegar, never to be combined because of the explosion they create. We view science as something that is objective and religion as subjective. Science is something that is factual and observable, whereas religion is just based on belief. However, our perception of these two are wrong. In reality, these two disciplines are more like hydrogen and oxygen. We need both. Religion has the proclaimed statements, and science is the evidence that can prove it. We can utilize religious texts in science to further our endeavors in understanding the world, from atomic interactions to how our minds function. Now, I am not here to convince anyone to believe in God or to be religious. I'm simply here to explain how religion can aid us in our scientific discoveries. How is this possible, though? Because for a very long time, science and religion have been butting heads. Well, I'm here to tell you that this so-called radical idea that religion and science are co-partners is not radical at all. In fact, when you look at many religions, they promote the unity of these two fields, from Christianity to Judaism to Buddhism to Islam. You name it, all of them are encouraging their followers to go into science to understand the world. In fact, one of the periods in time where these two were coexisting was during the Islamic Golden Age. People of all faiths and backgrounds worked side by side and produced many great discoveries. For instance, it was found during this time that the reason we can see objects is because of light bouncing off of them and entering our eyes. Many great discoveries like these were made, and just as those of different faiths coexisted, so did science and religion. Unfortunately, after the fall of this era, many of the work was lost, and eventually, the world began to view religion and science as two opposing fields, leading our society today to be divided on these matters. But there are and have been scientists who advocate for the band of religion and science, and in fact proved that the two complement one another. Who is a famous scientist then that has dared to dabble in these hot waters? Well, one of them was Sir Isaac Newton, the same Newton who discovered things like the three laws of motion. He actually tested the statements of the Bible against his experiments. He wanted to understand the truth of God, and through his calculations, he never observed a contradiction in religion and science. In fact, his life goal was to help people believe in God through his work, because what he saw was a well-ordered system of the universe that pointed to a creator. There are many religious texts that speak about the phenomenons of our world. Another example of this is the Vedas. It alludes to the idea of gravity in Vaishishika Sutra, which states, "Action of body and its members is also from conjunction with the hand," explaining that once the hand moves away, the object will fall. These verses are like riddles for us to guide our thinking and unravel the acts of nature. Now, a scientist from a modern era who proved that religion and science are a duo was a Nobel laureate in physics named Dr. Abdul Salam. He won the Nobel Prize for his contribution to the electroweak unification theory, which basically states that electromagnetic and weak nuclear force can merge and be a single interaction called electroweak interaction. He was able to make this discovery with the Quran, which speaks about beauty, symmetry, and harmony of the universe. Maybe you're wondering though, who recently has been able to show how religion can aid us in science? Well, I have. I utilize religion in science when I participated in a science fair. I wanted to understand why there is chirality and sidedness in nature. I wondered why at a molecular level, there is a preference of one kind of spin over the other. Like, why molecules of lemons spin to the right, but molecules of oranges spin to the left. It is not understood why these preferences exist. So that is when I refer to the Quran for some possible explanations. The Quran has tons of verses that talk about the right side more often than the left. We as Muslims are told to commence good things from the right side, such as eating. From this, I theorize that maybe the purpose of chirality is along the lines of Darwin's phenomenon of survival of the fittest, meaning that each rotation might have its own set of capabilities that the other does not have, leading to explain why we see these biases in nature. Even though I did not have the tools to test this out, I did walk away with more clarity in understanding this complex question. It is true, though, that there are many religious texts whose ideals possibly conflict with each other. But these variances are valuable because science is a melting pot. Dr. Salam stated, "There is only one universal science. Its problems and modalities are international, and there is no such thing as Islamic science, just as there is no Hindu science, no Jewish science, no Confucian science, nor Christian science." In other words, science needs multiple perspectives to solve multifaceted problems. Though there may be these differences, there is also a common thread among many religions. When you look at the beginnings of human history, where there were no means of communication and people lived in complete isolation, in each of those countries, there was some sort of religion. Though isolated from each other, somehow these various religions had the unanimous unity in the belief that some form of higher beings exist. This is impressive, considering how difficult it is today to get our own siblings to agree with us. My point is that the basis of many, if not all, religions are similar. Let's take the Big Bang Theory as an example. Many religious texts allude to the beginnings of the universe and the continuous expansion of it. In Taoism specifically, it speaks about how the universe formed from two opposing forces, yin and yang. Sounds a bit similar to what science now theorizes, which is that the universe came from a tiny, hot, concentrated point which exploded and spread out. These commonalities give us more reasons to study religion in science. And religion, as we have just seen, can help give some clarity and insight. We're now going to do an experiment where we're going to look at specifically how religious texts aid us in science. We're going to take a look at how the Quran, for instance, gives us insight on how our vision works. There's a verse in the Quran that states, "Proofs have indeed come to you from your Lord. So whoever sees, it is for his own good. And whoever becomes blind, it is to his own harm. And I am not a guardian over you." This is stating that if we stop using our vision, we can become blind. Then there's another verse that says, "Those who have disbelieved, it being equal to them, whether thou warn them or warn them not, they will not believe. Allah has set a seal on their hearts and their ears, and over their eyes is a covering, and for them is a great punishment." This is explaining that if we stop using our vision, we can become permanently blind. Now, how does science support this? Well, three scientists named Sperry, Hubble, and Wiesel were able to show that in order for vision to develop, the eye needs to be exposed to continuous visual stimuli. So if one eye is closed for only a few days, there are permanent changes that occur in the visual cortex. And they found that if they did this for a long period of time, it leads to near blindness. There are many critics that question the role of religion and science and wonder why we should even incorporate it in science now. My response to that is, if you have both your eyes, why use only one of them? Science and religion are our lenses in seeing and understanding the world. So why only look at it from one angle? If we can utilize the works of philosophers like Plato and Aristotle in science, then why can't we do the same with religious texts? The greats before us, like Newton, encouraged this unity. However, as a society, we chose to ignore this, even with the evidence in front of us. And the consequences have led to a great division in religion and science. But we can make a brand new ending by learning from our past, just as we do when we look up at the stars. One of our basic human desires is for the quest of knowledge and to seek clarity. Whether that is to understand challenges in our personal lives or the problems we face as a society. Adding this new merged perspective can give us more insight and widen our vision. It can give us a deeper understanding of the challenges we face, such as mental health, quality of education, and even climate change. As a globalized world, we need to unite so we can find solutions to complex issues in science, politics, or any subject. Imagine just how much more progress we can make together. As Albert Einstein once said, "Science without religion is lame. Religion without science is blind." Thank you.